The main topic of this course are topological spaces, but a topological space is simply a set equipped with some additional structure which lets us talk about geometrical properties of this space. So, before we get to topological spaces by themselves, it will be good to review some basic set theory, because that's what we'll be using over and over and over again in this course. Now, I will assume that you have seen before most of the material on sets that I will be covering here, so we'll be going through this review quite quickly, and the main purpose will be to make sure that we are on the same page as far as set theory is concerned, and that we are using the same notation for sets. Starting with the beginning. A set is simply a collection of some objects, elements of the set. So here is a set, and there are some few elements of this set. I will be usually denoting sets by capital letters. So let's say that this is set A, and elements of the sets will be denoted by small case letters. So let's say this is element X, this is element Y, this is element Z. Some of the sets will be appearing in this course over and over again. So let's go through the list of those commonly used sets, just to fix the notation for them. So the first set on this list is the empty set, which is the smallest set of them all, because this is a set which contains no elements. The symbol for this set is this crossed circle. The second set on this list is the set of natural numbers, which we will be denoting by this thickened N. And this is simply the set which is consisting of all the integers greater or equal to zero. So this is set consisting of 0, 1, 2, and so on and so on. Next on our list, we have the set of all the integers, which we'll be denoting by capital Z. And now integers can be either greater or equal to 0, so can be natural numbers 0, 1, 2, and so on, but also in the set we'll have negative integers, negative 1, negative 2, and so on and so on. In some cases, it will be convenient to have a notation for the set of just positive integers, integers which are strictly greater than 0. So this set will be denoted by z plus, plus standing for positive, and this is the set which is consisting again of integers greater than 0, so 1, 2, 3, and so on and so on. Now, as you may notice, there is not much difference between the set of natural numbers and the set of those positive integers. The only difference is that the set of natural numbers is consisting zero and positive integers do not. However, in some cases it will be more useful to work with natural numbers. In some other cases it may be more useful to work with positive integers. So that's why it's useful to have notation for each of these two sets. Next, we have the set of rational numbers, and this set will be denoted by this thickened Q. Rational numbers are all the numbers which can be represented as fractions of integers, ratios of integers. So all the integers will be, in particular, rational numbers. So we'll have 0, 1, negative 2, positive and negative integers in the set of rational numbers. But then in the set, we'll also have those proper fractions, like, you know, 1/2, and negative 10 over 13, and so on and so on. And the last set on this list of sets which we'll be using commonly is the set of real numbers, which we'll be denoting by thickened R. And real numbers are simply all the numbers which can be represented on the real line. So they will be integers, 0, 1, positive and negative, negative 2. Then we'll have all the fractions, like 1/2 and negative 10 over 13. But then we'll also have all the irrational numbers, like radical 2, pi, and many, many others. So again, this is simply a list of sets that we'll be using very commonly. Now, going back to the general set theory and the general notation for all the sets, let's say that we have some set A. So this is set A. And let's say that we have some element of this set. Let's call it X. In order to denote that this element X is an element of the set A, we will be writing that X belongs to this set A. And if we will have some element which is outside of the set, and if we will want to denote that this element Y is not an element of A, then we'll say that Y does not belong to A. So again, this is just another bit of notation. In many cases, we will be dealing with sets which are contained in larger sets. So here is how this looks on this picture. Here we have the set B, but every element of the set B is also an element of this larger set A. So B is entirely contained inside of this set A. If something like that happens, if every element of a set is an element of some larger set, then we are saying that this smaller set is a subset of this larger set. And in such case, we are denoting that the smaller set B is a subset of this larger set A. The special case of this relation of being a subset is that the set A is always a subset of itself, right? Because being a subset means that every element of the subset is the element of the bigger set, but every element of A is an element of A, so A in particular is a subset of itself. In some cases, we will want to make a distinction between this special situation and subsets which are strictly smaller than the larger set. And in such cases where we have a set which is a subset of A, but which is not equal to A, so it contains fewer elements than this bigger set A, we'll be saying that this subset B is a proper subset. So proper subset means it's a subset which is not equal to the whole set. Here are some examples of subsets based on sets which we have seen already here. So first of all, empty set is a subset actually of anything, because empty set doesn't contain any elements, so it's a subset of any other set. So in particular, empty set is a subset of, say, the set of integers, of rather natural numbers. So remember, natural numbers are numbers 0, 1, 2, and so on. The set of natural numbers is a subset, say, of the set of integers, because integers are numbers which are, either positive or negative. So we'll have negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, and so on. Integers are a subset of rational numbers, because rational numbers are, integers, and then we have those proper fractions. And rational numbers are a subset of the real numbers, because the set of real numbers is containing all the rational numbers, and then it's containing more, it's containing also irrational numbers. So we have this chain of subsets given by various sets of numbers. And by the way, all those inclusions are inclusions of proper subsets, because as we are going from each of those sets to the next set is strictly larger than the previous one. Now, as I have told you already, real numbers will be appearing very frequently in this course, and we will be frequently working with subsets of real numbers, which are given by various types of intervals. So let's go through the list of intervals of the real line. So first of all, we can talk about an open interval. So given any two numbers A and B, an open interval, which I'll be denoting by those A, B in parentheses, so this is A one endpoint of the interval and B the other endpoint. This is a set consisting of all the real numbers which are strictly larger than A and strictly smaller than B. So geometrically, this is giving me this interval of the real line stretching from A to B. And now, since A and B are not included in this open interval, since we are looking only at the numbers which are strictly larger than A and strictly smaller than B, then I am denoting this A and B by those empty circles, just to denote that they are not part of this open interval. They are outside of it. Only numbers which are between A and B are numbers which are inside of this open interval. Another type of interval is a closed interval, and this one will be denoted by AB but in square brackets. And now this is a subset of real line which is consisting of all those numbers which are smaller or greater or equal than A and smaller or equal than B. So in this case, those endpoints A and B are included in our interval. So geometrically, this gives us this interval of the real line stretching from A to B, but now I'm denoting endpoints of this interval by those filled circles to denote that those endpoints are also a part of this interval. Closed interval includes its endpoints. And as the final type of intervals, we have those intervals which are half closed and half open. So they include one of their endpoints and do not include the other endpoints. So half closed, half open intervals, well, they come in two different types. Here is one type. So this is an interval which is opened on the left side. So I am denoting the left end of this interval by I parenthesis, and closed on the right side. So the right side is denoted by this square bracket. And this will be consisting of all the numbers which are strictly larger than A, but smaller or equal to B. So that's an interval of a real line, which is consisting of all the numbers between A and B. It also contains the number B itself, but the number A is outside of this interval. This endpoint A, it's outside of this interval. And of course, we have the sort of dual situation when we could take the real line and then take the interval half open, half closed, consisting of all the numbers starting with A and including A, and then going all the way to B, but excluding B, right? So an interval like that will be denoted by square bracket A, because A is included, and then B, and then parentheses, because B is outside of this interval. So that's another type of a half open, half closed interval. Going back to the general set theory, our next topic will be some operations that we can perform to combine different sets. So one of those operations is the union of sets. So the union of two sets A and B is simply the set consisting of all the elements which belong to either set A or set B. So we are taking elements of A and B, putting them together, and that's giving us a new example of a set. So here's an illustration how it is looks. So here is set A, here is set B, this is A, this is B. And the union of these two sets is consisting simply of all the elements which are in either of these sets. So that will be everything which is in A together with everything which belongs to this set B. The second operation is the operation of an intersection of sets. So if we take a couple of sets A and B, then the intersection of these sets is a new set which is consisting of all those elements which are common to both A and B. So the elements which belong to both A and to B at the same time. So this is the common part of sets A and B. So again, going to a picture showing how this looks like, we have set A, we have set B, this is A, this is B, and the intersection consists of all the elements which belong to A and B at the same time. So in this case, that will be all elements which are in this common part of A and B. So this first picture again, that's the picture of the union of A and B, and the second picture is the picture of the intersection of A and B. Now, in some cases, it may happen that we can have two different sets whose intersection is an empty set. So on the picture, it looks as follows, that we have this set A here, this is set A, and we have set B here, and there is just like nothing in common between them. So the intersection is an empty set. In such case, when this happens, we are saying that those sets are disjoint sets. So nothing deep to that, we are just introducing another piece of terminology that may come handy as we're studying those sets. Saying that sets are disjoint means that the intersection of these two sets is an empty set. The operations of union and intersection of sets, the way I defined them on the previous page, they were using two sets, but those definitions of union and intersection can be generalized to arbitrary families of sets. So if we have some family of sets, A sub I's, and this family can be either finite or infinite, can consist of arbitrary number of sets, then the union of this family is simply a set consisting of all the elements which belong to any of these sets of this family. So we are taking all the elements of those individual sets, putting them in a single bag, and this is giving us a new set, and this new set is what we call the union of this family of sets. And intersection of a family of sets is defined the same way. If we have a family of sets, then the intersection of this family is a set consisting of all the elements which belong to all sets in this family. So this is the common part of all those sets, elements which belong to all these individual sets at the same time. Now, another operation on sets that we can perform is the operation of a difference of sets. So in this case, we start with a couple of sets. So here is set A and here is set B. This is A and B. And now set A minus B, so the difference between A and B, is a set consisting of all those elements which belong to A, but which do not belong to B. So to obtain this difference, we are taking all the elements of A which are outside, which do not belong to the set B. We are removing everything which belongs to B. And the result of that is the set A minus B. As just another piece of terminology, in some cases we may encounter a situation where we have set A, set B rather, and inside of the set B we have a set A sitting as a subset. So let's say this is A. And then if we take the difference between those two sets, then the difference will be consisting of all the elements of B which are outside of this subset A. So this thing, more or less. And in that case, we'll be saying that this difference, B minus A, that this is the complement of A in B. This is a set consisting of all the elements of B which are outside of this subset A. So that's the complement. So again, you know, nothing deep to that, another bit of terminology that we may run into from time to time. These algebraic operations on sets I've been talking about so far, so taking union, taking intersection, taking difference of sets, satisfy certain relations which tell us how those operations are related to one another. So let's talk about those identities that these operations are satisfying. So first of all, we have so-called distributivity properties. And they tell us the following. So first of all, if I take an intersection of two sets, A and B, and then if I take the union of this intersection with some set C, then this is the same as taking union of A and C, taking union of B and C, and then taking the intersection of the results of those operations. So that's one distributivity property. The second is exactly the same, except that we are interchanging unions and intersections. So if we take the union of two sets and we want to intersect it with some third set C, then this is the same thing as taking intersection of A and C, taking an intersection of B and C, and then taking union of the results of those operations. So these are the distributivity properties of union and intersection. The Morgan laws are relating union, intersection, and difference of sets. And they are telling us the following. So if we take set A, and if we want to subtract from it a union of sets B and C, then this is the same thing as taking the difference between A and B, taking the difference between A and C, and then intersecting those differences. Now, as far as remembering this, the Morgan law is concerned, then the only tricky part is that where we have the union on one side, then this is becoming intersection on the other side. When we try to subtract a union of sets, then this is the same thing as subtracting one set, subtracting the other set, and then taking intersection of those differences. And the second De Morgan law is, again, you know, the same, except that we are interchanging union and intersection in this formula. So if we have set A and we want to subtract from it an intersection of sets B and C, then this turns out to be the same as intersecting, as subtracting from A set B, subtracting from A the set C, and then taking union of those differences. So again, the thing to remember is that this intersection which we have on one side is becoming union on the other side. A minus intersection of B and C is A minus B union A minus C. Now, I will prove here, let's say, this last identity, the second De Morgan law. The other ones can be proved in the same way. You can convince yourself that they hold in the same way. And if you haven't done it before in some other courses, then that's a good exercise in proving those other identities in order to understand why they work and how those operations on sets work in general. So, you know, the proof will be a proof in pictures. I will look how this side of this equation looks like, how this side of this equation looks like, and I will try to show you that those two sides are actually giving us the same set. So, the left-hand side of this equation, that's the set A minus B intersected C. So, if I would draw this set, then the picture would be as follows. I have set A, I have set B, I have set C, so let's label them. This is set A, this is B, this is C, and now I'm supposed to subtract from the set A the intersection of B and C. So now intersection of B and C is the set which is common to both B and C, so this is this wedge consisting of all those elements which are inside of B and C at the same time. So now if I'm subtracting A from A, this intersection, I will be getting all the elements which belong to A but do not belong to this intersection. So all the elements which are in A but which are outside of this intersection, right? So this, well, pinkish part, this is precisely this set A minus B intersected C. So that's how it looks like. So that's the left-hand side of this equation. Now let's have a look at the right-hand side. So on the right-hand side, we are supposed to take A minus B and A minus C and then take the union of these things. So let's draw how this looks like. We have set A, we have set B, we have set C. And then, so let's label them again. This is set A, this is B, this is C. Now, what is A minus B? A minus B is the set consisting of all the elements which belong to A but do not belong to B. So that will be the set which looks as follows. So this yellow part, that's the set A minus B. What is A minus C? A minus C is a set consisting of all the elements which belong to A but do not belong to C. So that would be everything which is in A but which is outside of C. So this is this part here. Now the union of these two differences, A minus B and A minus C, well, that's everything which belongs to either of them. So it means that the union will be consisting of everything which is shaded in either color, right? So that's this part and this part. So that's everything which was shaded. Well, but now if you compare these two pictures, then you see that what is shaded on one part is exactly, you know, what is shaded in the other part. So it means that what I am getting on the left-hand side of this equation is precisely the same thing as what I am getting on the right-hand side. So indeed, this equality holds. And as I said, if you would like to prove that those other identities, the first De Morgan law and both distributivity law, are satisfied, then you could do it the same way by just drawing some picture and checking that you are getting the same results on both sides of the equality sign. Now, moving forward, another operation on sets that we'll be frequently using will be the operation of taking Cartesian product of two sets. So what is Cartesian product? That's a new set which is consisting of all the pairs AB where the first coordinate of the pair comes from the set A and the second coordinate comes from set B. So this is the set of all possible combinations of one element from set A and another element of set B. Now, the following terminology which is related to this notion of Cartesian product may be useful from time to time. So given a set A, I will be denoted by A to the power N, where N is some positive number. I will be simply denoting the set which is obtained by multiplying this set by A by itself n times. So explicitly, what are elements of this set? Well, in the Cartesian product, elements are just pairs consisting of the first element is coming from the first set, second from the second set. So in this, n-fold product, so the nth power of set A will be consisting of all the n tuples A1, A2, through AN, where all those individual coordinates are coming from the set A itself. Now, probably the most frequent case of this notation we'll be seeing will be the case of taking the nth power of the set of real numbers. So we'll be looking at the set Rn. So this is just the real line, the set of real numbers multiplied by itself n times. So the elements of the set will be n tuples R1, R2 through Rn, where those Ris are some real numbers. Here is an additional piece of notation related to this operation of taking a Cartesian product of sets. So on the previous page, when I was denoting the product of sets A1, A2, through AN, then I was using this cross to denote the multiplication. But an alternative way of denoting a product is to take this pi, big pi, which is simple for product, from I equal to 1n of all those sets that we are multiplying. So just, you know, alternative notation of denoting those Cartesian products. Now, in this course, from time to time, we'll have to deal with products of sets which involve not just finite number of sets, like here, but involve infinite number of products. So we'll have some family of sets, A sub I, indexed by some perhaps very large set, like, you know, set, say, of all the real numbers, and then we'll have to form a product of all the sets in this family. So now I should explain how to think about elements of those infinite products, because if we are taking a product of finitely many sets, then, well, elements of that are just n tuples A1, A2, through AN, n tuples of elements coming from those individual sets. But how do you think about elements of those products when this product involves infinite number of sets? Well, so to explain it, let me first explain how to think differently about elements of those finite products. So if we have some finite product of sets and if we would like to think about its elements of a product A1, A2, AN, then an alternative way of describing those elements can be as follows, that this is the same thing as taking functions f, all the functions f, which are going from the set of indices of those sets, so the indices are numbers 1 through n, so from the set 1, 2, n to the set which is the union of those individual sets that we are multiplying, but we are looking only at the functions such that f of I, taking the ith index, it's giving us something which belongs to the ith set in this union. So why elements of the products and those functions are, well, more or less one and the same thing? Well, you know, if we have an element of this product, so we have this n tuple a1, a2 through an, then this automatically gives me a function of this sort, because then I can say, well, you know, the function is defined in such way that f of 1 is equal to a1, and this a1, by the way, is an element of a1, so this condition is satisfied. F of 2 is equal to a2, which is an element of a2, and so on. Fn is an, which is an element of an. So any n tuple, any element of this Cartesian product is automatically giving me a function of this sort. And vice versa, if I have one of these functions, so I know that f1 is equal to a1, f2 is equal to a2, fn is equal to an, then that automatically gives me a tuple. So writing those functions and writing those n tuples is essentially one and the same thing. You can think about elements of this Cartesian product as functions of this sort. So why is it useful? Well, you know, it's useful because now if I have an infinite product of functions, then of sets, then this description of elements of this product using functions still makes sense. I can say that if I have a product of any number of sets, AI, so elements of this infinite product, well, I can think of them as of a functions. And now functions going from, before those functions were going from the set 1 through n, but those 1 through n, that's where the indices of my sets, right? So in this case, my sets are indexed by this, by elements of the set I, so functions which will be going from this set of indices I to the union of the sets which I am multiplying. And again, I have to have this condition that f of I, the value of this function at index I, is something which belongs to the set a sub I. So the ith element is going to the ith set, right? So you know, so that in this way you can formally think about elements of products of arbitrary number of sets. And again, you know, less formally you can think about each of those functions as giving you sort of, you know, a tuple of elements, but tuple which is indexed by those individual indices, because I can say, well, you know, the value of this function is one of those elements of those sets, and that will be giving me the ith coordinate of this tuple. But the formal way to talk about those infinite sets would be the one which is using their description using those functions. So again, I am talking about it here because those infinite products will show up in this course at some points, and then it's good to know what we are talking about.